In 1798, at the age of 21, Carl Friedrich Gauss wrote a classic book called the Disquisitionis Arithmeticae. Here he laid out the modern idea of modular arithmetic. This technique takes a group of integers, partitions them into a finite number of sets, and then treats each set as a new type of number. Modular arithmetic has proven to be so useful, it's natural to try to adapt this technique to other areas. In group theory, this can be done using normal subgroups and quotient groups. To motivate the idea of a normal subgroup and a quotient group, let's first look at a concrete example, the integers mod 5. Here we will divide the integers into 5 sets, depending on the remainder you get when you divide the number by 5. The first set will be all the integers with a remainder of 0 when you divide by 5. In other words, all the multiples of 5, positive, negative, and 0. The next set is the integers with a remainder of 1 when you divide by 5. We continue this process. Those with a remainder of 2, 3, and 4. We can now stop because these are the only possible remainders you can get. Here's a critical observation. If you pick any number with a remainder of 1 and add it to any number with a remainder of 2, you will always get an integer with a remainder of 3. Similarly, if you pick any number from the 2 set and add it to any number from the 4 set, you will always get a number in the 1 set. This always happens. If you pick any number from one set and add it to any number from a second set, the sum will always be in the same third set. These 5 sets are called congruence classes, and if we treat the sets as if they were numbers, then we have a group with 5 elements, the integers mod 5. It's very good practice to check that these 5 metanumbers do indeed form a group under addition. For instance, the set of the multiples of 5 act as the identity element, and each set has an inverse. By the way, whenever 2 integers a and b are in the same congruence class, we write it like this. We say this aloud as a is congruent to b mod n, and all this means is that a and b have the same remainder when you divide by n. Let's take another look at the integers mod 5 using the language of group theory. To start, we have the group of integers z under addition. This group has an infinite number of subgroups, but we'll look at the subgroup of the multiples of 5, which we'll write as 5z. Graphically, let's represent the group of integers by a rectangle, and the subgroup 5z as a smaller rectangle inside of it. Every integer in this subgroup has a remainder of 0 when you divide by 5. The number 1 is not in the subgroup, and if you add 1 to every number in the subgroup, you get a new set, the set of integers with a remainder of 1 when you divide by 5. We'll denote this set by 1 plus 5z. We call this set a coset, and it's not a subgroup. It's not closed under addition, doesn't have inverses, and does not contain the identity element. It's not even close to being a group. This coset does not overlap with the subgroup 5z, since every number in the coset has a remainder of 1 when you divide by 5, and every number in the subgroup has a remainder of 0 when you divide by 5. We can continue this process by picking a number not already inside a rectangle, like 2, and then making a new coset, 2 plus 5z. Continuing this process, we get the cosets 3 plus 5z, and then 4 plus 5z. At this point, the original group is now completely covered by one subgroup 5z and 4 cosets. By the way, you can also think of the subgroup as a coset, 0 plus 5z. We use the subgroup 5z to partition the group z into cosets. Because the cosets form a group, we call 5z a normal subgroup. And the group of cosets is called a quotient group, and it's written like this. This name is very descriptive, since we are using a subgroup to divide the group into cosets. And when you divide one thing by another, you get a quotient. But the critical insight in this process was the observation that you can treat these cosets as elements in a new group, a coset group, if you will. For example, if you add the coset 1 plus 5z to the coset 3 plus 5z, you get the coset 4 plus 5z. The way you add these two cosets is to add all the numbers in the first coset with all the numbers in the second coset. The resulting set turns out to be exactly the coset 4 plus 5z. I'd like to point out one more thing. In the example we've discussed, we started out with a group z, then took a subgroup 5z, which is called a normal subgroup, and used these two to create a quotient group out of the cosets. The quotient group is not a subgroup of z. It's an entirely different group. Let's now begin the process of generalizing this technique to an arbitrary group. Suppose we have a group G and a subgroup N. Here, we will use multiplicative notation for the group G. Like before, we can use N to generate a collection of non-overlapping cosets. Remember, N is a subgroup, while the other cosets are simply sets. Here is a big question. Do the cosets always form a group? The answer is no. If the cosets do not form a group, we do not call N a normal subgroup, and we cannot make a quotient group. Let's now see what properties N must have in order for the cosets to be a group. Let's assume N divides G into T different cosets. Since G may not be abelian, we need to be careful. Left cosets and right cosets may be different, so we'll go ahead and work with left cosets. Now, every left coset is of the form Gn for some element G in the group. Let's pick two different cosets, Xn and Yn. Since N is a subgroup, it contains the identity element E. This means X times E, which equals X, is in the first coset, and Y times E, which equals Y, is in the second coset. So if the cosets behave like a group, X times Y must be in the product of the two cosets. In other words, Xn times Yn should equal XYn. If this is true, then the product of any element in the first coset with any element in the second coset should be in the coset XYn. Let's see when this happens. Pick an arbitrary element in the first coset, call it x times n1. And then pick an element from the second coset, y times n2. If we multiply these together, we get xn1 times yn2. If this is in the coset xyn, then their product must be xy times n3 for some n3. We're now going to tinker with this equation to get a simpler expression. We can simplify this by multiplying on the left-hand side by the inverse of x and canceling. Next, multiply on the left by y inverse and cancel on the right. Finally, multiply this on the right by n2 inverse. Since n is a subgroup, the product on the right is also an n. So we end up with y inverse times n1 times y is an element of n. In fact, if you look at the set y inverse times n times y, you get n. One way to do this is to show each side is a subset of the other. We just showed the left-hand side is a subset of n, and it's a very good exercise to show that the right-hand side is a subset of the left. So to summarize, if the product of the two cosets xn and yn is well-defined, then it must be true that y inverse times n times y equals n. We call the left-hand side a conjugate. Now that we have a group operation, we can check that the cosets form a group. The identity element is just a subgroup N, which you can also think of as a coset En. We see this as the identity because En times Gn equals E times Gn, which equals Gn. And for each coset Gn, the inverse is G inverse N, because if you multiply these two cosets together, you get G times G inverse N, which equals En, or simply N, which is the identity element. We just saw that if N is a subgroup of G and the cosets behave like a group, then it must be true that the set Y inverse times N times Y must equal N for any Y. But with a clever trick, we can show the converse is true as well. That is, if the conjugate of N always equals N, then the cosets form a group. Let's see why. Suppose Y inverse times N times Y equals N for any element Y. We'll use this fact to show that the cosets form a group. To begin, pick two cosets xn and yn. Let's multiply two arbitrary elements from these cosets. Here's a clever trick. Y times y inverse equals the identity element e. Multiplying by e has no effect, so let's insert y times y inverse right after x. In the middle of this expression is y inverse times n1 times y. But from our assumption, we know this must be an element of the subgroup n, call it n3. So this expression equals x times y times n3 times n2. But n3 times n2 is also an n, call it n4. So the expression further simplifies to x times y times n4, which is an element of the coset xyn. This means the product of the cosets xn and yn is a coset xyn. The cosets do form a group. What we've just shown is that if N is a subgroup of G, then the cosets behave like a group precisely when Y inverse times N times Y equals N for any element Y in the group. When this is true, we call N a normal subgroup of G, and we write it like this. The group of cosets is called a factor group, and it's written like this. In the factor group, the subgroup N is the identity element, and the inverse of xn is x inverse n. Every group G has two subgroups, the identity element and the entire group G. It turns out these are technically normal subgroups, but they aren't very interesting. If a group has no other normal subgroups than these two, then we call G a simple group. A simple group does not have any factor groups, and they are the building blocks of other groups, much like prime numbers are the building blocks of the integers. Normal subgroups and quotient groups are among the most useful devices in abstract algebra. In separate videos, we'll show how normal subgroups determine what kinds of homomorphisms are possible from a group G to other groups. And for finite groups, you can find a chain of normal subgroups called a composition series, which acts as a kind of prime factorization of the group. Normal subgroups can even be used to study fields. You'll learn about this technique in Galois theory. Here's a good exercise. Try to find a normal subgroup of the symmetric group S3. This group has only 6 elements, so you should be able to check everything by hand. Be sure to help each other out in the comments below. And remember, only you can click the subscribe button.